Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Today, St. Paul tells us, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, he says, keep your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so that's what I want to talk about today, the peace of Christ. And this is so important, because this is what we need. We need the peace of Christ. When our Lord, in the gospel constantly, when he would greet people, he would greet them with his peace. When he appeared to the apostle after the resurrection, he would greet them with his peace. My peace be with you. St. Francis, the great saint, instructed all his friars when they would greet people, they would greet them by saying, the peace of Jesus be with you. In the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, read, go over the Mass. How many times is the word peace mentioned throughout the Mass? Because our Lord wants to give us that peace. And peace is such an awesome gift, the peace of the Lord, that no money in the world can buy it. Nothing can touch it, and nothing can compare to it. And if you don't have peace of the Lord, you're being tortured then. It's sad, my friends, how many people come to Mass even every day, and they still don't get it after 20 years, 10 years. They don't have peace. Why not? And so we want to strive for this peace of the Lord. And so I like to quote from St. Pio. He tells us what this peace is. St. Pio says, I quote, peace is the simplicity of spirit, the serenity of conscience, the tranquility of the soul, and the bond of love. Peace is order. It is harmony in each one of us. It is a continual joy that is born in witnessing a clear conscience. And it is the holy joy of a heart wherein God reigns. Peace is the way to perfection. Or even better, in peace dwells perfection. This is a great St. Pio. And the quote there, but look what he said. One of the most important things, he says, peace is a continual joy that is born in witnessing a clear conscience. When we have a clear conscience, it is the holy joy of a heart wherein God reigns. Not you, but God. When our hearts are filled with ourselves and pride, there's no room for God. And we wonder why we have no peace. St. Pio goes on to warn us then, he says, and the devil, who knows all this very well, does everything to cause us to lose our peace. So he attacks us. He doesn't like it when he sees you at peace. And so he's going to do everything to take that, rob that peace away from you. And so we need to pray for this gift of peace. There's a book that I'm going to recommend today. Every once in a while you come across a spiritual book that is gold. And this book that I'm holding in my hand, I cannot recommend enough. It's a small book, but it's called Searching For and Maintaining Peace. Searching For and Maintaining Peace. It's a small treatise on the peace of heart by a priest named Fr Philippe. And it's only $6. It'll be the best $6 you ever spend in your life. And I've been handing this book out for a long time. And believe me, people's lives are changed when they start reading this book and implementing this into their life. All of a sudden, peace will come. So I want you to examine your conscience today. Are you always agitated? Do you have peace in your soul? Even in trials and tribulation, our Lord wants us to have that awesome thing called peace. What did St. Augustine say? He said this, my heart will not rest, O Lord, until it rests in you. What's he saying? I will never have peace, Jesus, until my heart is one with you, till I rest in you. Why? Because he created us in his image and likeness. And he gave us himself totally. And we must give ourselves totally back to him, or we will never have peace. And so we will never rest until we have this peace. So over the years, I have worked with, privileged to work with many hardened sinners. And many of them come up and they'll start telling me how peaceful they are and how happy they are in their life of sin. And I look them straight in their eyes and they say, "You're a liar. You're full of it. You're a liar." And they look, they keep on persisting, but I keep on persisting. I said, "You are not at peace. It's impossible for you to be at peace because you're not doing God's holy will." And eventually they break down. And then they said, "How did you know that?" It's simple. You're not following God's way. And so I want to go over a tract by St. Francis de Sales, which is in this book. And it's only part of this book, a small part. And St. Francis de Sales tells us how to obtain this peace which is invaluable. And he says there's three main things. Number one, he says, let us have the very pure intention to do all things for the honor and glory of God. That's number one. So we must have this pure, a pure intention to do everything from the moment we wake up in the morning. Our first action should be directed towards God. Our hearts should be directed towards him. We should make acts of love, thanksgiving, whatever it is. But every act we do should be for God. And so we go through life sometimes and we say, "Oh, this doesn't matter." Everything matters, my friends. Every little thing you do, from brushing, combing your hair, to every little thing you do matters. And everything must be given to the glory of God. So this is the first step. If you want peace in your life and you don't have it, are you doing everything for the glory of God? When you start making that intention, just start making that intention. I want to do everything for your glory, Lord. I want to live and breathe for you and you alone. And when you do this, everything falls into place, my friends. Because when you love God, you will automatically love your neighbor. When you love God, you'll love your wife, your husband, and your children. And there'll be a peace there. And this is important. But you have to put God, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will fall in place. The second way to obtain peace, he said, is let us do the little that we can towards that end, towards God's glory, according to the advice of our spiritual director. This is a doctor of the church, my friend, speaking, not Father Isaac. But how many people have spiritual directors? And then how many people have spiritual directors and don't listen to them? And it's a very serious thing. So if you're serious about the spiritual life and you really want to do God's will, you need help. You need help to discern what that is. You need help to discern which direction God wants. It says in the scriptures, only a fool guides himself. How many fools here? Don't raise your hand. Packed. We're packed here with fools. We are. And so we got to wake up, my friends. And so spiritual direction is a very serious thing. Don't enter into it unless you're serious. Don't enter into it unless you want to obey the director. Don't waste his time, because I'll be honest with you, I'm a priest almost 11 years, and it's pitiful how many people have been serious about following spiritual direction. That's why usually I could tell very quickly, I cut them loose real quick, because you're not going to waste my time. Don't waste the priest's time, but don't waste your time. So if you don't have one, pray about it, and that priest can help you, guide you to the way of holiness. The next one, he said, is let us leave it to God to take care of all the rest. You hear what he said? St. Francis Sales is so balanced. He's so kind and merciful. Let us leave it to God to take care of all the rest. How many? All we do is worry. Worry about this. Worry about that. Worrying is a sign of a lack of trust and confidence in God. We're all guilty of it, starting with myself. And so do the two things above, and he says, just leave the rest to God. There's an old saying that God writes straight with crooked lines. He could do anything he wants. And if your heart's there, wants to fulfill his will, he'll get you there one way or another. He'll get you there, as long as your heart's disposed. St. Francis de Sales goes on to say, he says, why should anyone who has God for their object, for the object of his intention, and does whatever he can, be troubled? So in other words, if you've got God for your intentions, the end of everything, why should you ever be troubled? That's what, you don't. He says, no way. He says, of what should he be afraid? He says, no, God is not so terrible with those who love him. He's not a tyrant. He's not terrible with those who love him. He is content with very little, because he knows well that we don't have much. This is a great doctor of the church. Let me read that again. He says, God is not terrible with those who love him. We're that way, though, sometimes. So God is not terrible with those who love him. He is content with very little, because he knows well that we don't have much. He's a compassionate, awesome God. Once again, we're the exact opposite. We demand so much, not from ourselves, mostly from our loved ones and everyone else. They have to meet the high standard that we're not even willing to do. God's the exact opposite. And so I'm going to go through some tips from St. Francis. I'm going to continue. He says the next thing that is so important to keep peace, to have peace, is you must have humility. Peace is born of humility. Nothing troubles us but pride and the esteem that we have for ourselves. We are the biggest obstacles to holiness, my friends, ourselves. Our big ego. We have big egos. But God understands that too, because since the fall of Adam and Eve, that's the prominent vice. It's pride. We're focused on ourselves. Selfishness. And we all got to fight that. But if we want peace, you can't have it unless you're willing to be humble. So we must pray for that gift of humility. And humility means to accept who you are. You are a sinner. Don't be shocked when you sin. You do everything to overcome sin. You follow the rules. Don't get me wrong. St. Francis is not lax at all. But a truly humble soul, when he falls, you know what he says? Thank you, Lord, for all the graces you've given me that I didn't fall even worse. But most people, when they fall, especially those that are trying to be pious, they get so twisted and bent out of shape because they don't even realize. They think that's holy. No, it's your pride. You think you're better, and you think that's beyond you. I could never. How many people I hear, I can never commit a sin like that. Don't say that, my friends, because you may be humbled and commit worse. And so we want to pray for that virtue of humility, where we truly, number one, know who God is, and then we could know who we are. And when we have that gift, there's now peace can come to our soul. The next thing he says is that all things contribute to the good of those who love God. All things contribute to the good of those who love God. And as a matter of fact, since God can and does know how to draw good and evil, for whom should he do it? If not for those who without reserve have given themselves to him. You hear what he's saying here? We know that only God can bring good out of evil, and he does it time and time again. He'll use our own vices that we have to purify us, to make us saints. There's a true story of this book, and it's a great book called A Man Who Got Even with God. If you haven't read it, you should get it. It's an awesome story about this man. And he had a wicked temper. He had a rage. And God used that rage to get him where he wanted. He was a cowboy. He burnt down his father's farm when he was 15. He had to run away, and he was a cowboy. When he came back, he was 39 years old. His mother, father forgave him. Mother prayed the rosary for him every day. And all of a sudden, he started getting thoughts about being a monk. And there was a monastery not far. So one day at the dinner table, he told his family, "I'm going to be a monk." And they all started laughing at him. They said, "You, a monk, with that temper? What are you, crazy?" And he goes, "I'll show you." And he ran to the monastery that day, knocking on the door. And he said, "What do you want?" I want to be a monk." "No, go away." He goes, "I'm not leaving till you take me." And he said, so God used that stubbornness, that anger, and he pushed, and he got him in the monastery where he wanted. That man died a saint. And so God will use these evil things, these sins that we even commit. He loves us so much. He takes that and uses it for his good and glory. When Adam and Eve, the church teaches us that the sin of Adam, when Christ came and made reparation, atonement, we have a greater glory if we get to heaven than if Adam did not fall. That's how generous God is. That he took the fall of Adam and those that are faithful. Now we have a greater reward in heaven. And Adam sinned. We all sin. And so the whole point, St. Francis, is you're getting the point, I hope. Don't beat yourself up all the time. If you fall in sin, we're going to get to, yes, you have to repent. Watch out for the pride. Okay, the next, he says, one should absolutely desire God and God alone. Okay? And he says, but the means of serving God, he says, one should only desire them slowly and gently. So that if we are prevented from using them, we should not be greatly upset. But he's warning us, when we are on this road and we want nothing but God and God alone, go slowly, go gently. Why? Because so many people get caught up in the spiritual life and they start out like they're all on fire. We all experience this, I'm sure. And you're going to convert the whole world. And then you're working on all the virtues, every virtue you ever heard on. And you know what happens? You just fizzle out. You dry up. And then you give up. You say, "Man, this is crazy. I'm such a, look at me. I can't do nothing right." No. So that's why, go slowly and gently, but go forward. You know, keep going forward. Don't look back. St. Augustine said, if you keep looking back, you will go back. And so we want to do this slowly and gently. It's like a turtle. A turtle will keep walking. He'll get to his point. It may take him a while, but he'll get there. Okay? But if you start taking all these zigzags, if you take, you're going to crash. So listen to this great saint and go slow, but steady. The next point, he says, is that the measure of divine providence in us depends on the degree of trust that we have in it. You hear that? The measure of divine providence in us depends on the degree of trust that we have in it. Do not anticipate the unpleasant events of this life by apprehension. Rather, anticipate them with perfect hope that as they appear, as they happen, God, to whom you belong, will protect you. How many of us constantly say, "Oh no, this is going to happen, I know it." And we focus on negativity constantly. It's a lack of trust and confidence in God. So the graces don't flow as much. So St. Francis de Sales is telling us, if we have more trust and confidence in God, we will have more grace. And God will operate even more powerful. He says, remain at peace and remove from your imagination whatever may upset you. And say frequently to our Lord the following prayer. Oh God, you are my God, and I will trust in you. You will help me, and you will be my refuge. And there is nothing I will fear, because not only are you with me, but also you are in me, and I in you. It's such a beautiful prayer, my friends. Do we realize that when we're dwelling in the state of sanctifying grace, that the whole God, the Trinity, the world can't contain, is dwelling in your soul. So let us not focus. We are always focusing on the negative and the trials and looking at what's bad in our life. But we got to say, no, Lord, I trust in you. No matter how bad the storm is, I'm going to ride it out because you're the captain of the ship. And this ship ain't going down when you're on it. It's not. We see in the Gospel of Matthew, okay, the storm at the sea, it says, then he got into a boat, Jesus, and his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, and that the boat was covered by the waves, but he was asleep. So they came and woke him, saying, Lord, save us, we are perishing. But he said to them, why are you fearful, O you of little faith? O you of little faith. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the sea, and there came a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? My friends, that's us. We're in the boat. We're surrounded by storms. And if we just come to the realization and keep focusing on this, God's in control. I'm in the state of grace. He dwells within. Greater is he who's in me than the world. If that's true and it is, why do I have to fear the world? Why do I walk in fear? Why? How many people are in bondage from the devil and God's dwelling in your soul? Do you realize this? Meditate upon this and trust yourself to God. He'll never abandon you. And whatever happens in the storm cannot happen, because just as he calmed the storm with one word, he could calm the storms in your life. And if he's not calming them, it's because he's purifying you. And that's why the saints are at peace in their sufferings. At peace. Why? Because God's allowing this to me. Job was at peace. Why? God is allowing it. I need this. It's good for me. I could prove my love for God by showing him that I'm willing to suffer for him and trust in him. And trust in him. That's the toughest thing, my friends, to keep at peace. If you want to know if you have the peace of the Lord, you could tell, how do you behave in times of trials and tribulation? How? That's when we find out how deep our faith is and how deep our trust in God is. The next one is a big one. He says, one should avoid haste. Okay, one should avoid haste. Treat your affairs with care, but never with hurry or worry. Don't rush to your task because any haste upsets your reason and judgment, and even prevents you from doing well the very things that you are hurrying to do. And so when you do things in haste and rush, you're not accomplishing even what you want because you're not going to do it well. He says it affects your judgment and your reason. And it's true. You know, it's amazing. You could go to monasteries throughout the world, and where they're really faithful monks, they'll pray the whole office. They do all their prayers. And they built every building, stone by stone. How can they get this work done in such a short time? It's amazing. It's amazing. But they do, because when you're in religious life, when you're in the novitiate, you are taught, no matter what religious order you're in, that you never run anywhere. If my novice master was seen me running down the hall, forget about it. You don't run. You always walk. You carry yourself very calmly, very peacefully. No matter what, you're not supposed to run. You never go hastily anyway. So you do things, recollected, do them for God. And you'll get more done, my friends, than you do if you're running in haste. But once again, if you're seeking to do God's will and you're going to be faithful to your vocation, you're not going to put off, keep on procrastinating, especially when it comes to your obligations. So you want to do them promptly, but do them in a nice pace. Okay. The next, he says, the next tip is peace when confronted by our faults. We must hate our sins, but with a hate that is tranquil and peaceful, not with a hate that is fretful and troubled. Okay, we must have the patience to see our shortcomings and to profit from a saintly abasement of ourself. A saintly abasement, he's saying. So we have to have this hatred for sin. But St. Francis warns us, when you sin, yes, we must have sorrow. You must be sorry, and you know when you're sorry, when you amend your life. He says, but if you get depressed after you repent, he goes, that is a sign that the enemy has infiltrated, that the devil is there. He doesn't want you to trust in the mercy of God. Now he wants you to think about his justice. He says, no, but St. Francis says, no. So when you start feeling depressed, that's not from God. God loves to forgive sinners. And when you come to our Lord, repent. Be sorry. Amend your life. But then St. Francis de Sales said we should have a joy too. A joy that God has made it possible to forgive us. That he's so loving. He doesn't hold it over our head. He doesn't keep putting our sins in front of our face. We do that to each other. We don't forgive each other. And we're constantly telling your wife or your husband, throwing the sins for the last 10, 20, 30 years in their face. Knock it off. Knock it off. So he says, we must have the patience to see our shortcomings and to profit from a saintly abasement of ourselves. If not, your imperfections, which you see very acutely, will trouble you even more keenly, and by this means maintain themselves, as there is nothing which sustains our defects more than a sense of anxiety and haste to eliminate them. You hear what this great saint is saying? I'm going to read that again. He says, if not, if we don't do this, like he's telling us, your imperfections, which you see very acutely, will trouble you even more keenly, and by this means maintain themselves, as there is nothing which sustains our defects more than a sense of anxiety and haste to eliminate them. I'm going to become a saint tonight. I'm never going to do this again. It doesn't work that way. Grace builds on nature. And so just take the saint's advice and try to have peace in your soul when you're confronted. If you're humble, you will accept this. If you're humble, you'll own up to your faults. And the hardest thing is when people confront you with your faults. Because I remember when I was in the novitiate, the superior said, if you want to know your sins, he said, get a paper, a thick one, and get a couple of pens, because the person's going to run out of ink, and go to your brothers and tell them to write your sins down. Okay, we got plenty of them. We got plenty of them. And so the next, he said, is gentleness and peace in one's zeal towards others. That we must be gentle, we must be kind, gracious, peaceful, and enduring when it comes to others. That we want to be just like our Lord is. Kind, compassionate, not condescending, not looking down and say, look at you like the Pharisee. Thank God I'm not like the rest of them, Lord. Thank God I'm not a wicked man. And who was more pleasing to God? The wicked sinner. Wouldn't even lift his head up to heaven. But remember, as you judge, so you will be judged. So if you're not merciful with others, if you're going to treat them unkind, and you're going to be harsh with them, especially when they're sinning, you're not going to win them over to the Lord. You're not going to change anyone by being cruel, uncharitable, by being harsh with them. Same thing with sinners. You don't win sinners over like that. You win them over with charity, with love. And the last, and this is probably the most important one, St. Francis tells us, accepting without becoming trouble not always being able to maintain this peace. This is what he's saying. We have to accept the fact that no matter who you are, no matter how holy you are, you're not going to always maintain this peace constantly. Once in a while, you may stumble. Once in a while, you may lose that peace. Once in a while, you may fall. We know great saints, how many of them would fall into indeliberate venial sin, and God made it clear to them, I allow that to keep you humble. I allow that to keep you on your knees, because otherwise you'll start to think that you're doing it yourself and you're holy. And so the saints, when they fell like that, even though they were holy, they picked themselves up. You know, we get the wrong impression of saints, my friends. Some of us think that these saints never committed sins. Read the life of Saint Jerome and Saint Augustine. They used to have battles. You should read their letters that they wrote to each other. They were sinful. They were mean and cruel to each other. Saint Jerome had a fiery temper. But he's a saint. He's a saint. So let us pray to Our Lady today, Our Lady who is Queen of Peace, okay, that she will grant us the efficacious grace, that we will always search for peace and then maintain it, that we will do everything in our power to keep this as our goal, because perfection lies in peace. I really encourage everyone to get this book. It's only $6. It will change your life if you meditate it. I can't tell you how many people that I've given this book to, and they had big problems. They had problems with rage, unforgiveness, hatred. And they start praying. They go to Mass and they're struggling, because it's frustrating when you're going into that confessional and you're coming out the same you feel every time. The devil wants you to give up. Don't give up. But just have mercy and patience with yourself. Our Lady has all these graces we need for all of us to become saints, for all of us, that no matter how bad the trial is, the tribulation, that we can remain peace, because we know Jesus is there in the storm and He is in control. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.